Hello and welcome to the channel. Most chances are that either you or people around you are trying to reduce weight, or in the very least try not to gain further weight. There is no shortage in methods for weight loss, but perhaps the most critical problem is that many individuals are incapable of maintaining their weight loss and for the most part return to their original weight. In addition, obesity is a major worldwide health concern. In fact, the worldwide prevalence of obesity, both in adults and in children, constantly increases and is responsible for various medical complications that include increased blood pressure, high cholesterol levels, diabetes, heart problems, depression, anxiety, and more. Research in the area of satiety and hunger in the last decade has focused mainly on signals that affect the balance between hunger and satiety. This includes hormones such as leptin or GLP-1 that was actually recently approved by the FDA as a treatment for weight loss. It is commonly thought that people gain weight when they ingest more calories than they spend. However, despite the common knowledge that, energetically speaking, a calorie is a calorie, different food sources are differentially metabolized, with some metabolic pathways more efficient than others. In addition, different food sources affect differentially on the brain centers responsible for regulating our sense of hunger and feeding behavior. It is nowadays understood that the different food types greatly affect biological processes that determine when, how much, and what we will eat. But is it possible to affect how long we can hold without food until our next meal? This may seem like a psychological question. Do I have a strong enough willpower, or can I refrain from thinking about food? A research paper recently published in the journal Nature Metabolics has addressed this question of what determines how long can we hold until our next meal. The researchers in this study tracked over 1,000 healthy adults in both the US and England for a duration of 2 weeks. Every day, participants in this research were asked to eat breakfasts that were pre-made and provided to them by the scientists. This study included 7 different breakfasts with different ratios of sugar, fat, protein, and dietary fibers levels, but that all of them contained identical number of calories. During the 2 weeks of the research, the participants switched between the 7 different breakfasts every 2 days. This was done in order to measure the levels of sugar in their blood following ingestion of different types of diets. The exact amount of sugar, fat, protein, and fibers in each of the 7 different diets are shown on your screen right now. Following their breakfasts, the participants were asked to fast for 3 hours and were told that once they finish the fast, they can eat as much as they would like. Importantly, participants carried a sensor that constantly measured their blood glucose levels as well as their activity levels. The timing of the meals and their subjective hunger levels were updated by the participants themselves using a dedicated app on their mobile phones. So what typically happens following a meal is that blood sugar levels rise significantly, which drives an increase in blood insulin levels. Insulin in turn causes a dip in the levels of glucose in the blood to a level lower than the baseline, and it takes a little while until the blood glucose levels stabilize. The researchers in this study were interested in understanding whether the dip in blood glucose levels following a meal affects the eating behavior of the participants in this study. To accomplish this, following each meal, the investigators divided the extent of the dip in the blood sugar levels into quartiles, such that in the fourth quartile, or Q4, the dip in the blood sugar levels was the most significant compared with the first quartile or Q1. What the researchers found was that in participants with the largest dip in blood sugar levels or Q4, the sense of hunger following breakfast was the strongest. Indeed, time to the next meal was shorter for those with the largest dip in blood glucose levels or Q4. As a result, this caused more energy to accumulate in participants with largest dip in blood glucose levels, or again Q4. This can lead to a higher weight gain. In other words, the dip in blood sugar levels during the 2 to 3 hours following meals reflected the size of the meals that the participants ate during the following 24 hours, as well as corresponded to their hunger reports. The researchers noticed that the most significant decrease in blood sugar levels following meals happened following eating pure sugar, which was actually one of the 7 breakfasts that the participants received. This observation strengthens epidemiological studies that showed a strong correlation between consumption of sugar-rich foods such as potatoes or sweetened beverages to an increase in weight gain. However, the dip in blood sugar levels is only one part of a much greater picture, since hunger and satiety are both affected by additional factors, including social, psychological, and physiological factors. The strengths of this research are in the fact that it was conducted on many subjects, more than 1,000, that could actually consume their breakfasts and be studied in their own home environment, rather than in the environment of a laboratory, which makes this a more realistic scenario. Also, some of the parameters, specifically blood sugar levels and activity levels, were measured in an unbiased and non-invasive manner, which reduces stress level that can otherwise affect the outcomes. In summary, this research strengthened the link between the increase in consumption of sugar-rich food products to the increased prevalence of obesity throughout the world. That would be all for today. Until the next research paper, stay safe.